What will it profit a man to gain the whole world and mess around and lose his soul? I can tell you, absolutely nothing. Cars are nice and houses are wonderful and money is good to have. But let me tell you something. Folks, in the afterlife, you ain't gonna take none of that stuff with you. Amen, somebody? And yes, God has all of these blessings for us, but I would never settle for the lesser blessing unless I had the greater blessing already on lockdown. Amen, somebody? For this world is not our permanent home. I like that, because if it's not our permanent home, it tells me that we should not get too comfortable. If this is not our permanent home, you should not be too caught up in the stuff that's happening all around you, because we didn't come here to stay.
Peace and blessings, everybody. It's Pastor Troy Wynn, Sr., the senior pastor of the Freedom Church, with you one more time for our online Bible study. As you've heard me say before, during the summer months, we take our Bible study exclusively online so that our members can enjoy the summer break and still stay connected wherever they are in the world. That being said, I'm super excited to talk to you tonight about this particular Bible study. And it's one that's near and dear to my heart. Here's my pastoral push. I pray that when this is done, if you are not a believer, if you are not someone who has a healthy relationship with God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, that something I say will be the impetus to you beginning to seek God for a relationship that supersedes every relationship that you have. That being said, the topic tonight is simple. It's what I love about God. What I love about God. And I'll tell you the first thing I love about God, and I'll give you two things. But the first thing I love about God, I love God's creativity. Man, when I think about creativity, God blows my mind. When I look at John, the first chapter, the third verse, I'm reminded of not just his creativity, but his creative power to create any and everything and all things using absolutely nothing. That is the apex of creativity. Here's what John 1:3 says. Through him, all things were made. Catch that now. Through God, through Christ, all things were made. Watch this. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. You talk about creativity at its apex, that through God, through Christ, all things were made. And there's nothing that was made that he was not involved with, that he did not have a say in, that he was not the creator of. Jesus worked with God the Father and the Holy Spirit to create everything that there is. Now, I want you to just think about that for a minute, because that's a whole lot of creativity. I'm talking about everything from honeybees to elephants, from pine cones to clouds that we see in the sky, to rainbows, to red birds that we see flying around during the summertime. And I can't forget about this. You and I exist because of God's creativity. You look at the creativity of God and you see diversity. You see that none of us are alike, though we may have similarities. They say that every human being has its own distinct individual fingerprint. Talk about creativity. And the good news is that you and I are made in God's image and God's likeness. This is why one of the things I love about God the most is his creativity, because if God is creative, then I am creative. If God is creative, you are creative. And I want you to know that you are creative. Oftentimes, though, our creativity is limited to the things in our imagination. Limited to the things in our imagination, because when we get ready to create, we have to use materials that already exist, like paper and computers and paint and metal. We have to use things that already exist. But God created things out of nothing. Now, I'm about to say something that should really open your eyes to the hidden power that you possess. Everything that exists is here because God made it. And catch this, God created it all from nothing. Now you say, Pastor Choi, what's your point? Oh, I'm so glad you asked. If God created all of these wonderful things from absolutely nothing, and you and I are made in God's image and God's likeness, how many of you know where I'm going? Then there has to be the divine ability inside of you and inside of me to create in spite of the things we don't have. Woo, good God Almighty. So that's why I love the Word of God, because when I read about God, I'm also reading about myself. When you study Scripture and you study what God is, you must always keep in mind that He's placed a fragment of that inside of you so that you could function at a supernatural level. Now, there is the natural level of creativity. I just told you we have to use things that already exist. But you need to broaden your understanding and enlarge your perspective to know that because you are made in God's image and God's likeness, especially if you're flowing with God and you're walking with God and you have a relationship with God and you're in commune with God, or as I like to say, common union with God, you've got access to supernatural ability to create in spite of what you do not have. That means you can create and you don't have all the money. You can create and you don't have all of the support. You can create and you don't have any of the ingredients that the world says you have to have in order to create that which you're trying to create. Yeah, I hear you, but I'm not limited by you. You have got to start embracing that God is creative, and because God is creative, you are creative. As a matter of fact, why don't you just say this prayer? Let's unlock some creativity today. Say this with me. Say, Dear God, You've made so many amazing things. Help me be more creative like You. In Jesus' name, amen. Guys, if y'all can get a hold to that one, that God is creative, and embrace it, and then start living with the expectation that no weapon formed against you can prosper. Start living with the expectation that says, I might not have this, that, or the other, but because my Heavenly Father is the master of creativity, then within me resides the divine ability to create in spite of what I don't have. I love it. Now, I told you I was going to tell you what I love about God. I'm only going to give you two, because I want to give you two that you can chew on, meditate on, and more importantly, incorporate in your life. When I teach, I expect for people to apply what I teach. I don't want you to think about it. I want you to be about it. I don't want you to try it. I want you to do it. Now, I've given you the first thing I love about God. It's what? It's the fact that God is creative, which means because God is creative, I'm creative. Because God is creative, you are creative, and you're never boxed in. You're never locked out. It's never over as long as you're rocking with God, because we serve a Heavenly Father who has created so many things from nothing. And then He dropped a little bit of that inside of us so that you and I will know that no matter how bad it is, how dark it is, how rough it is, how tough it is, we've got a way out, we've got a way in, we got a way through, and it's called the divine creativity of God. Okay, that's enough of that. Here's the second thing I love about God. Are you ready? Write this down. Number two, He saves the best for last. My. Let me say that again. The second thing I love about God is that He saves the best for last. I get this from John, the first chapter, the fourth verse. God has given me a unique way to look at Scripture and see sometimes what people don't see initially, but to help them see it when we get finished talking about it. And this may be one of those cases. It says, in Him was life. Him being God, Him being Christ. In Him was life. Peep this. And the life was the light of men. Woo. Man, there's like 100 points of revelation in that one verse. For the sake of brevity, though, I'm going to stick to this one. God saves the best for last. That's what I love about it. Well, Pastor Troy, I'm not connecting the dots. You're telling me God saves the best for last, and then you're reading that in Him was life, and the life was the light of men. I'm not seeing the correlation. I'm not seeing the connection. That's what I'm here for. There are two kinds of life. Let's connect the dots. Would you agree with me? There are two kinds of life? Sure. One is here on earth. That's the life we're living right now. But understand this. The other life is a life with God. Two kinds of life. Don't miss this, because I'm going to throw something at you that should bless your whole life. What kind of life are there? There's two kinds. One on earth and the other is with God. Peep this now. Life on earth will end one day. I don't think I've got anybody that's going to disagree with me on that. Yeah, life on earth is going to end one day. You and I have seen people pass away. We have family members that have passed away. And you and I both know that our time is coming. The Bible says it this way, that it's appointed to every man to die once. So life on earth is going to end. But remember, I told you there are two kinds of life, life on earth and life with God. Here's the good news. Life with God, it will never end. I can't rush through that because I want to give you a reason to love God, give you a reason to hold on to God, give you a reason to cling to God and not let go, not give up, not throw in the towel. Life on earth is going to end, folks. But here's the good news. That ain't the only life available. Woo. That when this life stops lifing, there's another life that keeps on lifing. I like that. What is it? It's a life with God. It will never end. Here's what I'm telling you. Catch this now. God is the maker of both kinds of life. Yeah, the life on earth, God made that. The life with God, God made that. So you got to understand something. God made both kinds of life. Here's the question, folks. Real simple one. I'm going to throw a low softball. Throw it slow so you can knock it out of the park. Which life is the best life? Life on earth or life with God, the one that never ends? Simple, right? The best life is the life with God. The best life is the life that never ends. The best life is the life in the presence of God, where you are living with God in peace, where there is no more pain, no more sorrow, no more disappointment, no more death. Only love, only peace, only harmony. Yeah, that's a simple question. Which life is the best? Shucks, the one that's with God. And here's what I want to tell you. God saves the best for last. Now, I want to encourage you because this world seems to be going cray cray every day. I want to encourage you because the prophecy of the Bible is true. I've seen it come to pass that in the last days, many will fall away from God. So I want to encourage you to make sure you don't miss the best life, investing everything you've got in this life. Because remember, I told you, there are two lives, and there are going to be a plethora of people who are going to miss the best life. Talking about, I'm living my best life. No, you're not. You can't live your best life on this planet, because your best life is the next life if your current life is in Jesus Christ. Woo! Say it again, PT. Your best life is the next life if your current life is in Jesus Christ. So be careful that you don't miss the best life, investing everything you got in this life, as many are doing today. Don't have time for God, don't have time for reading the scripture, don't have time for praying, don't have time for church, but they are fully invested in the things of this world. They're fully invested in the cares of this world, and God has been tossed on the back burner or thrown out the back door. If you can hear this, if you can see this, I want to encourage you to wake up. I want to encourage you to understand that this life is an illusion, that this life is a deceptive trap that desires to consume your attention so much that you absolutely forget that there are two lives, that you absolutely forget that this life on earth, it's going to end, that you absolutely forget that the best life is a life with God and it never ends. And the best life is the next life. I don't care how good things get in this world. I don't care how good your life is right now. And yeah, God came that we might have life and have it more abundantly. God actually came through Christ and died and rose from the dead so that we could be prosperous and enjoy this life and have good times here on this planet. Yes, he did. He has no problem with that. But you must understand that the best life, it's the next life. if your life is invested in Jesus Christ. Now, when I talk about being invested, I'm talking about you pouring yourself into the will, the word, and the way of God. I'm reminded of Matthew, the 20th chapter, verse 16. The King James translation says it best. Says, so the last shall be first, and the first shall be last. Oh, shucky ducky, quack, quack. Let me read that again. Matthew 20 and 16. I'm going somewhere, guys. It says, the last shall be first. And then it says, God's going to say, reverse, reverse. And the first is going to be last. I told you, the second thing I love about God is what? Man, he saves the best for last. And what you must understand, please don't miss this. This time that you and I have, this space that you and I have on this planet. I'm talking about this mortal life that we have here and now. It's our opportunity, brothers and sisters, boys and girls, cats, dogs, and squirrels. It's our opportunity to choose eternal life with Jesus Christ. Yeah, every time we breathe in and out, every time we open our eyes, every day God gives us, it's an opportunity to choose eternal life with Jesus Christ. Here's the catch, folks. You have to choose eternal life while you are still in existence in this life. Because once you expire in this life, choosing time is over. Ooh. Once you breathe your last breath in this life, the one I told you was going in, then choosing season is over. You no longer get to choose. And many people are going to wait too late to make the right choice. Many people are going to be so consumed in this world and the cares of this world and the activities of this world and the fun of this world that they're going to miss their window of opportunity to choose eternal life with Jesus Christ. And I told you, man, my pastoral push today is that if you don't know Christ, if you don't know God in a relationship, I just want you to understand that today would be a great day to surrender all to God. Today would be a great day to say yes to God. Today would be a great day to say, you know what? I don't want to miss the best life. Yeah, I want to have some fun down here and I want to have a good time here. I want to enjoy this life, but I don't want to miss the best life because I didn't make an investment in my future life. Woo! See, here's what I want to tell you, brothers and sisters. Once you and I have chosen Jesus Christ, we got one assignment, guys. It's our job to make sure others have the same opportunity to choose Jesus. That means we aren't just saved to go to church. We aren't just saved to go to heaven. Nah, we're saved to spread the good news. We're saved to make sure that everybody who's anybody knows that God saves the best for last. And here's another quick question. If you are a believer, if you have a relationship with Christ, if you're saved, as we like to say, who needs you to tell them about this choice that they've got to make? Who needs you to tell them that God is saving the best for last? Who needs you to tell them that the next life is the best life, and this life, no matter how good it is, there's something better coming? But you have to make the choice. See, this life is the only chance we get, folks, to make that choice. And somebody needs you. If you are a believer, if you're someone who has surrendered your life to Christ, you know him for your Lord and Savior. Come on, brothers and sisters. Somebody needs you to tell them that God saves the best for last. Somebody needs you to tell them that God loves them. Somebody needs you to tell them not to miss their opportunity to choose the best life. Because every single one of us is going to have to stand before God. The Bible says we're going to have to stand before God and give an account to God for our lives, the things we've done, the things we've said. Imagine explaining to God why you didn't choose him. Imagine trying to explain to God why you didn't stick with him. Imagine explaining to God how you were going to come to church once you got yourself together. Imagine explaining to God how you didn't go to church because you didn't want to be a hypocrite. Imagine explaining to God that you didn't believe in him. You talk about a horrible day to try to explain something to God. It's going to be the day you stand before him. And I don't know about you, but I'm trying to miss all of that. I'm trying to stand before God and not have to explain nothing. I'm trying to stand before God and hear him say to me, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Enter in. That's what I'm living this life for. That's why I won't give up. That's why I won't give in. That's why I won't turn back. That's why if I fall, I'm getting up and I'm going to continue to run this race. Why? Because I'm trying to hear those words come out of his mouth that says, well done, thy good and faithful servant. But folks, he can't say well done if you haven't done well. Woo! Good God Almighty. Who am I talking to that God has placed this video in front of? And you know it's time for you to surrender. You know you've been running and running and running and running and avoiding God the best way you know how, which is by avoiding God's people, by avoiding church, by avoiding anything to do with faith that would have you have to take a look at yourself and have you have to be honest about the knowledge that you possess in light of the choices that you made. And listen, know this, God ain't mad at you. Used to be a song back in the day saying, I ain't mad at you. God ain't mad at you. Nah, he ain't mad at you. He loves you. And he's using every opportunity available to reach you while you're still in your choosing season. That's why he hasn't given up on you yet. That's why he's patiently waiting on you. That's why he won't force you to choose him. Because love wants to be chosen freely. And I'm challenging you today. If you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, I'm not talking about going to church. I'm talking about you have a working relationship where every day you repping the kingdom. Every day you're striving to be better. Every day you're striving to overcome. Every day you're striving to reduce the sin and destroy the sin in your life. And every day you're striving to live holy, which simply means to live set apart and set aside for God's purpose. This is God's will. This is the way. And folks, we're all running out of time. Nobody knows how much time they have left. But here's what I want you to know. If today is your last day, please don't waste it investing in this world when you have not invested in the best life, because the next life is the best life. And those are the two things I share with you. There are others. I may do a part two with this because there's so many other things I love about God. But I just wanted to share those two with you. Two things that I love about God. I think that you can agree, you know, two great reasons to love God. If you don't know him as your personal Savior, listen, all you have to do is really reach that place in your heart and your mind where you're ready to surrender. You do not have to be perfect because none of us are perfect, but you do have to be prepared to surrender. You don't have to be perfect, but you do have to be prepared to say yes to God's will, God's way, and God's word. You don't have to be perfect, but you do have to be prepared to start the course and stay the course. And when you fall, you get up and you continue on the course. And if that's you today, I want to pray the most important prayer I could ever pray for you and with you. If you'll join me by simply repeating after me, saying, Heavenly Father, I hear your voice today, and I want to say thank you for your grace and your mercy. I want to say thank you, Heavenly Father, for your patience, and I want to say thank you for the time you've given me to make the decision that I'm about to make. Today, I choose you, God. Today, I repent of my sins. Today, I confess my sins. And today I confess Jesus Christ as both Lord and Savior of my life. Today I trust you. Today I believe you. And today I walk with you according to your word, by faith and not by sight. Help my infirmities, help my sins, help my weaknesses, help my idiosyncrasies, because I want to be more like you. And with your help, God, I will become more like Christ. I declare today that I am saved in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, and amen. Well, hey, if you prayed that prayer today and you meant it with the most sincere heart possible, I want to welcome you to the family of God. If you prayed that prayer today and you gave your life to Christ, leave a comment, leave an email address, and we will email you some information on what to do next. If you're near the Warner Robins, Georgia area, I want to invite you, if you don't have a church home, that is, to come join us this Sunday, 10 a.m., and let one of our elders or ministers know you gave your life to Christ. We can put some literature in your hands, and maybe we can begin this journey together. If you're not close to the city of Warner Robins and you gave your life to Christ, you need to locate and find a local church to become a part of the family of God. Listen, God loves you. He cares about you. And he wants you to have the best that he has to offer. Just remember, God saves the best for last. Have a blessed day.